We're going to re-talk about hypotheses. At first, hypotheses look easy to talk about, and I've said they are over-defined, and people over-explain them. And the definition really isn't what we want to focus on. We want to focus on the application of the concept. So again, what we're looking at is a hypothesis is a prediction of a study of an experiment. Let's stop here and realize not all studies are experiments. Not all studies are experiments. There's different types of studies. Let's stick for right now with an experiment because that's what people know. Let me predict that if I give you caffeine, if I give you coffee, you're going to pay attention more. Throughout today's class, we want to use that model, and I want you to be skeptical. Pick that apart. How many of y'all think caffeine will help you pay attention? All right, how many of y'all don't think caffeine? How many of y'all didn't raise your hand? All right, so here's what we're looking at. You need to be skeptical of my hypothesis that caffeine will allow students to pay more attention. And as I say this, immediately I want you to start thinking. I want you to be, for lack of a better word, an attorney. Imagine you're an opposing attorney in a courtroom. You're starting to pick apart my argument.
You're Sherlock Holmes starting to pick apart detail by detail. Give me right now one thing you think is wrong with my hypothesis
that says caffeine will help you pay more attention in class. What's that?
Oh, really?
Oh, okay. Yeah, I know. They don't pay attention. I know some of you are like, really? He's freaking out right now. Please give me one thing that you think is wrong with this hypothesis. Go ahead. Excellent. I like that. Go ahead.
It's sort of like her spreadsheet. Caffeine doesn't have the same effect on
you. Excellent. Anyone else is skeptical? Go ahead.
Some people might be caffeine
addicts,
so it really helps someone with
his
withdrawal symptoms.
That's cool. So similar to what she said, we have different subjects. Go ahead. Or, I'm sorry, participants. Go ahead. They could already be paying attention. How do we define paying attention? Believe it or not, it is impossible to find a perfect study. You can have, to some extent, a near-perfect design, but the implementation, where you actually start doing it, there's always going to be a problem, and I always want us to be skeptical. Next time someone says, well, research says, you need to immediately start thinking of 1, 2, 3, 5, 10, or 20 things that are wrong with that research that might cause us to doubt the results. I'm not
saying science isn't good. I'm saying people too blindly
accept it. So let's go back again and look at hypothesis, rejection of null hypothesis, and this thing called significance. Null hypothesis, again, is a prediction. Nothing significant will happen. When I say significant, you need to know, if you don't have this written down, I want you to write significant means not due to chance. In fact, that's so important. Everyone stop. I want you to take your pen, put it in your non-dominant hand. Take your pen, put it in your non-dominant hand. We're going to break the rules. We're going to be risky. We're going to be crazy. And I want you to write significance means not due to chance. Just write the word significant. Just write the word significant in your non-dominant hand. I see some of you are awkwardly doing it. And there's one child in the back, I'm not doing it. So what does that mean? Go back to our example. Go back to our example of flipping a coin 100 times. And if you were to say a spell, and you find out that your spell influenced coin flipping, 52% of the time it landed on heads, 48% of the time it landed on tails. Well, guess what? That's better than halfway. You did it. Your spell worked. But I don't think that's what we call significant, because could it just be chance? Sure. That's what significant testing means. We need to eliminate chances. Let's take a look at what's called parapsychology. Parapsychology is that weird thing that deals with telekinesis, which is moving things with your mind, reading people's thoughts. Can you predict the future? Can you see through a wall and just know what's there? And many of us would like to believe that stuff is possible. And I'm going to say this before. I'll say this right now. This is critical. I suspect that as you've grown older, you have stopped believing in cool things. Is there anyone here who in the last 3 years has tried to figure out if you have superpowers? All right, we got a couple. Good. Now ask your parents. They're like, no. All right. Now think about how silly you'd be. If you grow up and you don't believe in superpowers, that means you don't try every day. How mad would you be if you realized you could have flown or stuck to walls or turned invisible for most of your life? You just never knew it. How frustrating would that be if you're like, oh my God, you mean I could have flown to work every day? But you never tried. So here's your homework. I want you tonight, go out in the backyard and try. Try to fly. Your mom's like, what are you doing, honey? Like, mom. She doesn't know. So again, we're looking at parapsychology, and that is the, and let's face it, I'm going to be honest, it's not really well respected. There are some well respected psychologists who've done work in parapsychology, but no one has yet been able to reject null. No one's been able to say that there is a significant effect for people being able to read minds, predict future, or anything like that. Alternative hypothesis. We need to write this down, and as notice it's written H subscript 1. Alternative hypothesis is what we're most familiar with. Very few people are familiar with null. So when we look at alternative hypothesis, what we're basically saying is something significant will happen. So let's look at this thing called significance. And we've talked about significance means it's not due to chance. And one of the ways we're going to look at this, we've introduced N, we've introduced H. Let's introduce another letter that's an abbreviation for a concept in psychology. And it's going to be P italicized. When you're reading research and you're looking at the conclusion section, and this is it, this is the big thing, did it work? One of the things you can almost skip to, scan all, and a lot of psychologists do this, a lot of researchers do, they scan through the whole article or go to the results section, they look for P. Is P less than 0.05? Now let's do some math. I want you to convert the decimal 0.05 to percents. What do we got? 5%. Which means we want to make sure we're 95% certain the result is not due to chance. We can't ever be sure. Some experiments go a little bit further, go 99% where P is less than 0.01. So what you want to quickly go through and look for is P greater than 0.05. If P is greater than 0.05, we're not sure we can buy the results. Go ahead. That's correct. Our goal in any research study is to eliminate as many things. We're going to learn what those things are. Let's call, right now we'll just call them things. Our goal in research is to eliminate as many things as possible that might screw up the study. That might mean it's due to chance, due to an accident, due to something we didn't expect. And so the concept we use is significance. And the more significant it is, the less it's due to chance. And we say that something is significant if it's past the 95%. So if we're 95% sure it's not due to chance and it's due to our pill, our treatment, our interaction, our whatever it is we did, then we say it's significant. Questions? Go ahead.
It's like really close, like not quite.
Welcome to science. Let's look at all the ways we can have errors. Don't write down this yet. We're going to write down a chart. So what I'd like you to do is usually take a half page of this. A half page of this, and let's write down this chart. And I'm basically saying leave like three lines here, three lines here, three lines here, three lines here. So we're going to make a big chart. And while you're doing that, I'm going to take attendance. Anyone here proud of your chart? You're like, anyone here kind of ashamed of your chart and it looks kind of nasty and you don't want to show it to anyone? All right, fair enough. Your chart just look, let me see. Oh dear. I'm just kidding. All right. So here's the deal. We're talking about predictions, hypothesis, null hypothesis, alternative hypothesis. And we want to basically, we've got problems. If we look at whether or not we could predict and it could be wrong, we could predict and it could be right. We could predict and we could be right, or we could wrongly, oh dear, this is confusing. If we have results are significant, which means P is less than 0.05, which means there's better than a 95% chance, it's not due to chance, and we predicted it. We were right. Guess what? Coffee does help people pay attention. I predicted it. My tests show it. Guess what? That's not an error. We like that. We're going to reject null. We're going to accept the alternative hypothesis. My study worked. And maybe, just maybe, when I write it up and I submit it to journals, peer-reviewed journals, they'll accept it. And they'll publish it. So this is nice. My study worked. Let's go on to the other option. I think caffeine is going to help people pay attention. But guess what? I find out, oh dear, I got a type 1 error. We'll call it false alarm.
I think it worked.
I think
it's going to work. Didn't work.
The experimenter thinks the results are not going to be significant. That didn't work. Stupid experiment.
Nothing ever worked. Mom was right.
And then I find out, oh my gosh, it did work. Well, guess what? That's an error. That's called a type 2 error. So what we would do is we're going to put an error. We're going to put an arrow right here. Those two are errors. When we look at this chart as to whether we can accept null, okay, or we reject null, type 1 error, type 2 error, you can think of a weatherman. But, you know, weatherman is going to
make a prediction,
just like a hypothesis. Either there will be a storm or there won't be a storm. And the weatherman has to be careful. If the weatherman or weather person, I don't want to gender discriminate, the weather person says there's going to be a storm. Oh my gosh, everyone panic. Go out to the store and buy everything. Go slash your neighbor's tires. I don't think they say that, but people get in a panic situation. So if you go and panic and panic and panic, and guess what? There's no storm. That's bad. We all get mad at that. So the weatherman's going to learn his lesson. Her lesson. It's like, oh, you know what? A storm's coming, but last time I got burned, it probably won't amount to anything. I'm going to predict there won't be a significant storm. Well, guess what? There is a significant storm. That's a problem. Or the weather person is going to say, there is a storm, and a storm does happen, that's a hit. Or they say, there is going to be a storm, and guess what? A storm doesn't happen, that's a hit. I mentioned the concept of peer-reviewed journals. So, you're not writing it down. I want you to turn your notebook upside down. And I want you to write now. Peer-reviewed journals are the closest thing we have to fact. All right, put your pens down with authority when I know you're sir, I know you're done. Got it. I had one kid in my 8th period class. I said, put your pens down with authority. Everyone did it. He's like, I said, that's not authority. He says, I don't do that. I'm like, oh, no, you didn't. Peer-reviewed journals. Let me tell you what it's not. All right, peer-reviewed journals, not Time Magazine. Not going to be your newspaper. We've all been in arguments, or maybe I get in more arguments than most people, and it's, oh yeah, well, I read it. Next time someone says to you in an argument, or they're trying to prove their point, I read it, I want you to say, where? Remember, be skeptical. Where did you read it? Oh, well, I read it in the newspaper. Ha, I have now. Okay, and then you need to ask the question, did the reporter actually do the study? Was the reporter actually there?
Or are they interviewing someone and reporting back the summary?
Peer-reviewed journal, not this. Oh, this looks good. It says Scientific American Mind. All about psychiatry, psychology, the mind, the brain. Talking about sociopaths. How we can be smarter. Improve our sleep. Better dreams. But you know what? This article only reports about studies. It doesn't publish the actual studies word for word. Which leads us to a possible reporting error. If you really want to know what's going on in science, you actually have to read the actual peer-reviewed journal. What the heck is a peer-reviewed journal? Well, number one, it's a journal, a magazine, published for experts by experts. So what does that mean? That means it's written in scientific jargon. It's written by someone who knows what they're talking about for someone who knows what they're talking about. It's not really for popular consumption. Oh, you can subscribe to it. But unless you're an expert in a field, it might kind of go above our head. So this system of peer-reviewed journals, if you do a report and you accept or reject null, that might be important. So you write a report and you submit it to a journal and they publish it. Ah, but look who's going to read it. People who know as much or more in your field than you do. They're going to read it. They're going to pick your stuff apart. Oh, yeah? I don't think you did this right. I don't think you had the right sample. I don't think you did your significance testing correctly. Or they might agree with you, take your result, and keep going. This is how knowledge is built. Experts sharing information back and forth and kind of checking each other's work to make sure that people aren't kind of running away in the wrong direction and claiming they've cured something when they really haven't cured something. That's the beauty of what's called peer-reviewed journals. Baseline. Baselines are something that are exceedingly rare to hear about in the news, especially when you're talking politics. Oftentimes you're going to get a politician, and oftentimes educators, school, university presidents, CEOs of corporations, they're kind of in many ways politicians. They got to convince people of a certain thing. They say, in this last year, we have created a zillion new jobs. We have increased the bottom line X percent. We have made more and more children do better on the SAT. From when? When are you counting? Where's your starting line? And if you don't do this, you can't really test your significant effect. So baseline, if you want to write down all these words, that's fine. Just write baseline to starting line. That's all you have to write. Let's go down and talk about the category of variables. A lot of variables. And the quick definition is any factor that changes in a study. Any factor that anything that changes in a study. Some things we want to change. Some things we actually do the changing of. Some things accidentally change. Some things screw up the study. And it's very hard to control for all variables. And that's actually going to be the key. How much control do we have? Because the more control we have, that means the less things are going to be due to chance. And we're going to look at this relationship. The more control we have, hopefully the better chance of significance. Well, you know what? The first one's going to be the independent variable. We see a lot of fancy words up just there. Just write the thing the experimenter manipulates. The thing the experimenter manipulates. That's all you got to write. And then so for dependent variable, all we're going to write down is the result. So try not to over-explain them. Just like hypothesis, we don't need to over-define it. We don't need too many words. If you need an example, in our class, if we're going to proceed with this study, the independent variable is the cup of coffee I give you. The dependent variable is paying attention. Now, we can measure how much coffee, and maybe we can measure how much caffeine, but how are we going to measure paying attention? I would say eye contact, body position, whether or not your eyes are actually closed sleeping. Where I find the interesting stuff and where when we talk about skepticism comes when we talk about variables, we got to talk about confounding variables. Confounding variables, or another way to say it, is going to be what's called a lurking variable. This is something that sneaks into your study. You didn't anticipate, you didn't notice, and messes with your results. It could be chance, it could be accident. It could be the fact that your participants, you know what, there was a great Monday night football night, a Monday night football game on the night before you studied them, and they stayed up late. Maybe they stayed up late and they drank too much. And as a result, they're not very rested. Is that going to mess up your study? Absolutely. Maybe your subjects, your participants had a really bad day in traffic. So there is almost an infinite amount of confounding variables or lurking variables that can just mess up your study. Which again, go back to the idea of control. The more control we have, the less it's due to chance. So let's talk about a placebo. All right, so here's the campus myth I use to explain placebo effect. All right, imagine there's a fraternity. Homecoming weekend. All right, they have this huge house and they're going to have the party, man. They want it to be epic. So what do? They get a band. All right, they actually have it catered, and they bring up a beer truck, just bam, park it right on the lawn. And you know what they're going to do? Is the party is so good, people are actually leaving homecoming football game to come to the party. I mean, it's crowded in the street, it's rocking, it's amazing. And everyone is getting a little bit loose. They're getting sloppy, ugly people are starting to look good. All right, it's not good. Why would I say that's not right? All right. So people are dancing. After a while, people getting on with each other. You know, they're in the bushes, all sorts of... Right? I know. And then the president of fraternity stands up and says, all right, cut the music, got the mic. Excuse me, everyone. All you people dancing, can you stop? You know what? I just want to let you all know the party's going to continue in a second. I just got to make a quick announcement. All of the beer you've been drinking is non-alcoholic. Everything you've been doing is not due to alcoholism. Wow. What do you think about that? That's called the placebo effect. And the reality is your mind is extremely powerful. You don't believe me? Think of something embarrassing. You can feel the butterfly. You can feel your face get red. It changes your blood flow. It changes the chemistry in your body. You think of something that scares you a little bit, you get nervous. And your butterflies in your stomach reflect a change in blood flow. Your mind can cause a reaction in your body. So check this out. If I'm going to give half of you caffeine and half of you not caffeine, is it the fact that the caffeine is making you pay attention? Or is it the fact you think the caffeine is making you pay attention? Are we studying the chemical reaction or are we studying the placebo effect? That's tough. That's what we call confounding variable. Now, people love placebos because it's kind of cool. It's the idea that you mean if I take a fake pill, it can actually have a real effect? The answer is yes. If this is true, why would we ever give real medicine that has side effects? You've seen those commercials where they have, take this medicine, and at the very end they list through like 10,000 side effects. Especially like irritable bowel syndrome. I don't want that, and that doesn't sound good at all. Possible death. I don't want that either. That's no good. Go ahead. Exactly right. Placebos, by definition, include this thing called deception. Should we apply this to perhaps cancer treatments? Should an oncologist give real chemo? Or should an oncologist give fake chemo because the mind is strong enough to reduce the tumor? Now we get into what we call ethical issues. But if the placebo is a belief and the belief is based on deception and your doctor tells you the truth, there goes the placebo. Please know the effects of placebos are not fake. For my dorks, let's remember when Harry Potter gave Ron Weasley the good luck potion when he was the keeper in the Quidditch match. How many of y'all are kind of happy now? You're like, yeah. You're giggling. Why? No. All right. Boys and girls, I'm going to say this many times. This is a classroom. We are here to pass standardized tests, not learn, not be creative, not actually be excited about the learning process. All right? Our job is to memorize facts dispassionately. You with me on that? Thank you. Interested. This is cool. That's going to stop right now, young lady. I'll tell you that right now. All right. As we talk about placebos, we're going to introduce a word called a nocebo. All you need to write is a negative placebo. So the idea with a nocebo is it can create a malfunction. Now, why would you want that? Why would you want medicine not to work? Well, for some people, they've been sick for so long, that's what they know. Even though they have negative symptoms, even though the symptoms are painful or uncomfortable, they're comfortable with it. If you have depression, and you've had depression for a long time, maybe you're, for lack of a better word, accustomed to it. Change is hard. It's threatening. You don't want to have to go back to work and get better. You like being sick, the comfort of it. It's a theory. Questions? All right, we're moving on. Let's talk about your experimental group. The experimental group is the group of people that gets the pill or the caffeine or the new treatment or the something. The experimental group gets the independent variable. Well, of course, that's going to therefore mean
the control group gets the placebo.
What am I talking about? If I gave half of y'all a cup of coffee and I wanted to figure out, well, I'm going to have half the group is going to get treatment, a cup of coffee to see if you pay attention more, and the other half's not. Well, the group that's not is going to, oh, I didn't get coffee. You'd be all mad, put your head at your desk. Are you not paying attention because you didn't get caffeine, or are you not paying attention because you know you're not being studied because you didn't get anything? And those of you got a cup of coffee, are you paying attention because of caffeine, because you think caffeine will work, or because you know I'm studying you? So the way to do this is I must give the control group a placebo. I'm going to give everyone a cup of coffee. Just half of you all be caffeinated, and half of you will be decaf. And let me quickly say here, decaf coffee is bad. It's from the devil. It's like white chocolate. I don't know why someone would make it. It's like smoking while you're jogging. It doesn't make sense. Next time, I know I'm going to snap. I'm going to kirk out if I'm at Starbucks and I'm on my own business. And someone in front of me is like, hi, can I have a white chocolate decaf macchiato? I'm just going to punch him in the back of the head. It would be on the news. That's not right. Why would I say that? Hawthorne effect. The Hawthorne effect simply means, well, duh, you know what? People don't act naturally. People don't act naturally if they're being studied. Now, some of you have told you to be skeptical. You're supposed to point your finger at me and say, prove it. Give me evidence. How do we know people don't act naturally? Well, I want you to get a camera, and I want you to shove it in someone's face and just follow them around. And like, they'll be like, stop. Like, why? Just act natural. It's difficult to act natural on camera. Maybe you've never been at a wedding where someone shoves a camera in your face and says, just act natural. So let's do this. Where are my athletes in the class? Okay, then. How insulted would it be if I look at you like, you're an athlete? No, that's not right. Why would I do that? So if you're an athlete and the coach is, all right, go take a lap. Like, sure, coach, go. And you run off. When you're on the other side of the field, do you slow down? Yeah, you darn right you do. All right, so we're like, no, oh man, Jaguar pride, rock. All right. It's not right. So what we're looking at is when the coach isn't looking, when the teacher isn't looking, when your boss isn't looking, when the cop's not looking, we act natural. When they are looking, we're on our best behavior. So if you're a volunteer, if you're a participant in a research study, you're not going to act normal if you know what's being studied. The Hawthorne effect comes from, well, a researcher. And I'm going to butcher the details of the story, but the gist of it is this. The gist of it is a business owner wanted to make his workers, his seamstress, it was a garment factory or a garment business. He wanted to make his seamstress work faster. There's only about six of them. And so he's thinking, this is in the 20s. Let's use this new thing called psychology. You know, the idea of Watson. Let's do this idea. How are we going to make my employees work harder? So they opened the windows, and the employees worked more. They made it colder, and the employees worked more. They made it warmer, and the employees worked. Played music, the employees worked harder. They turned the lights down, the employees worked harder. And what we find out was it wasn't any one variable. It was the fact they knew they were being watched. If your boss is watching you, you work harder. So the Hawthorne effect is something that's bad. So I want you to write down Hawthorne effect is a confounding bias. The Hawthorne effect is a confounding variable or a bias or a lurking thing. Because again, what are you studying? Are you studying caffeine? Are you studying the pill's efficacy? What's called efficacy. Did the pill actually work? Or are you studying whether or not the person's just acting differently? Are you guys packing up? We haven't even gotten anywhere yet. What time? Oh! You signed up for the class, man. Sorry. You're the dummies that signed up for AP Psych. Don't blame me. All right, I'm not saying I wish you harm. All right, but probably an embarrassing encounter with a mud puddle.